I'm here with Natalie Battaglia from NASA Ames Research Center. She's an astrophysicist, and I want to ask a few questions. First of all, Kepler is running out of fuel. So how do you feel about that?
Kepler has been pretty much my whole career. I started working on the mission during the proposal phase in 2000, before it was a mission. I've watched it grow from the selection, when it was just an idea, to it being selected by NASA, to building it, to conceptualizing it, to running it, and seeing all of the planet discoveries come out. So for me, it's been an 18-year process. Now, Kepler was only supposed to live for 3.5 years. The requirement was that it survive for 3.5 years, and it ended up taking science for a full 8 years. So it more than doubled its lifetime. But more importantly, I've seen how Kepler discoveries have catalyzed new branches of science. I mean, really driving the search for life beyond the solar system. It has motivated future missions in a very tangible way. So I don't feel sad because I see so many amazing things coming down the road, and also because we accomplished more than we set out to do. So I feel very gratified with the mission, and I feel like it is time to pass the torch on to the next mission that's coming, which is TESS and JWST, the James Webb Space Telescope. And I really look forward to seeing those missions succeed in the same way that Kepler did.
What kind of exoplanets do you think we can discover with James Webb Telescope?
TESS and JWST are partners. So you can imagine exoplanet discovery in decades, stages, if you will. So for the first decade or two, we were finding the very first exoplanets, and it was kind of like a stamp collecting process. You know, every one you discovered was just this amazing thing. We were so excited, and you look at every new planet as this, you know, precious thing. So, but then Kepler launched, and exoplanet research became more about demographics. Now the exoplanet discoveries came pouring in, and it was more about populations, looking at statistics and, you know, what fraction of stars in the galaxy host planets of certain sizes and orbits, and what could we say collectively about exoplanets as a whole? What is the diversity of exoplanets? That's a question you can answer when you have a statistical sample. Now, with the launch of TESS and JWST, we're moving into another stage of exoplanet research, which is all about atmospheric characterization. So we're not necessarily going to be discovering new planets with James Webb. We will with TESS, but not so much with James Webb. James Webb is going to take planets that have already been discovered, and it's going to observe them in a very special way in order to collect light that is passed through the atmosphere of the planet.
Yeah.
And through that mechanism, we will be able to say what the chemical composition of the atmosphere is. We will be able to say what its temperature and pressure profile is.
Is oxygen.
Maybe. Oxygen is more difficult. So James Webb has the sensitivity to characterize the atmospheres of planets smaller than Neptune, but probably not as small as an Earth, unless it has very special characteristics. A planet like Earth orbiting a star like our Sun in a one-year orbit, that's going to come later with future missions, not the James Webb Space Telescope. But you know, Kepler found a class of planets that we don't even have in our solar system, and in fact, these planets are the largest number of planets known to humans right now. They're these kind of super Earth sub Neptune planets that we don't have in our solar system. In our solar system, we've got the tiny terrestrial worlds, you've got the big gas ice giants, and not really anything in between.
Yeah.
And yet those are the planets that we find the most of.
Yeah.
We don't know what they are, but the James Webb Space Telescope, by studying their atmospheres, will be able to say if they are planets more like Neptune or more like a super Earth, if they have atmospheres that are rich in hydrogen and helium molecules, like water vapor, for example, CO2, methane, these kinds of things.
One last question. What about exomoons? Is it possible to characterize them, to detect them? Is there a possibility for doing some research?
Well, you know, we had hope of doing that with Kepler. The idea was that if a planet is passing in front of a star and causing a dimming of light, if it had a sizable moon, you might be able to see evidence of that dimming as well. And the idea was to look for planets like Jupiter that had a moon like Pandora in the movie Avatar, something that, like an Earth-sized moon, it's a very large moon. And especially if you have such planets in the Goldilocks zone, or what we call the habitable zone, where liquid water could potentially pool on the surface, that would be very interesting. And in fact, Kepler found many dozens and dozens, if not hundreds, of such planets, giant planets orbiting in the habitable zone. So teams went to work analyzing the Kepler data, searching for these tiny signals that could be accompanied next to the primary transit. And so far we've not come up with anything. The problem is that we're right down at the edge of our sensitivity limits. I mean, we're really looking down in the weeds for these signals. More importantly, the signal that you're looking for is not strictly periodic, like the primary planet transit, right? With a planet transit, it comes back around and it transits at exactly the same time every single orbit. With the moon, you've got now another time scale, which is the orbit around the planet.
Yeah.
That beats with the orbit of the planet. And it's going to beat in maybe a syncopatic way, not necessarily periodic. That just means that you don't know exactly where to always look. You can't average the data together, fold the data and average it together in order to have a better chance of finding it. It makes it more complicated. So it could be that they're there and we just haven't had the sensitivity to find them yet. But certainly people are looking very hard.
Somewhere there is something really incredible waiting to be known. Thank you very much, Natalie.